This week, Joey and I got to hunt the beautiful country of Namibia. Neither one of us had ever been there before, so we were really excited for this hunt. We got to hunt with our good friends Devon and Julia Labuschagne of DL Safaris. We had set up an incredible hunt for some animals that we had yet to have the opportunity at, but more importantly, we had talked with them about donating these animals to a very special cause, which you're going to see at the end of the show.
But does Namibia have the poaching problem that South Africa does?
They do.
Yeah.
Up in Etosha National Park.
Okay.
There's quite a bit going on. They caught two guys the other day. Guys from Zambia and guys from Namibia.
Were they poaching rhinos?
Yeah. Wow. They were caught with rhino horns and tusks.
Because they'll poach elephants too, won't they?
Yeah.
Wow. That's cool. I know, it's a problem. We have poaching back home, but nothing like you guys have.
Yeah.
I mean, that's crazy.
South Africa is bad.
Yes.
They poach up to 400-500 a year, I think.
Johnny!
How's it feel?
Okay.
Doesn't kick, ne?
We're going out today to look for gemsbok.
We're going to look for gemsbok. What we do is we drive around to certain places where we know they like to hang out. We'll probably stalk in and see what's there. It's nice and cold this morning.
The guys wanted to give me every opportunity to shoot my trophy. They went as far as coming together to build me an elevated tree blind as well as a ground blind to make sure I had every opportunity available.
Thank you.
Gemsbok are extremely skittish animals. We had to move quickly and quietly to even get close enough and in good position to take a shot. We had blown a few stalks, so I felt a little pressure to get things done. We had seen a huge male Gemsbok, and that was the trophy I wanted.
Bigger than 33 inches.
Bigger than Aaron's.
So today started out pretty slow. We weren't seeing a lot of Gemsbok this morning. Finally around 10:30,
we were driving up over a hill and we spotted three gemsbuck. One was this beautiful guy. One of the reasons I wanted one so bad was I love the color of their face, love the horns on these things. And one of the things I learned was the older they are, the closer the rings around their horns. And we ran into this guy, had a few minutes to stalk him, and ran up over the hill and got one shot into his lungs. He ran a few yards, got another shot into his backside, and he went down, and I ended up getting him.
Well, Joey, we've been hunting for, what, 2 days now?
Yep.
We saw probably over 100 oryx.
We did, yesterday.
And we had some close calls, and we knew it was going to come together sooner or later.
Yep.
Well, this guy's absolutely beautiful. He's going to score well. He's long, he's wide, he's thick. So I'm excited to get a tape on him.
I'm excited. He's beautiful. Thank you.
Welcome.
Devon and Julia certainly know how to treat their guests. They would cook over the braai, or an open fire as we like to call it, every night. They had two wild rhinos that would come in, and what an experience that was. They became part of the family as well. This was just the perfect way to enjoy Namibia.
You're a fabulous cook.
That was so perfect. A little bit of soup with some meat. I was like, oh, man.
I love the meat with that.
You know what? I didn't kill anything until I had the meatballs. Next trip, we eat meatballs first day.
It's still cold this morning.
Where are you originally from?
I'm originally from Germany.
And how did you make your way to Namibia?
Well, my way to Namibia was kind of a stomach feeling. I wanted to do a thing like a volunteering with horses, and there I found my way to Germany, to Namibia.
So you started out in Germany as a registered nurse.
Yeah.
And then you right. came here to do some work with horses.
Yeah, I wanted to do something different, something out of my job. And horse riding was always a long hobby from childhood.
And you worked on a farm in Namibia
yeah.
with the horses.
Right, yeah.
And that is where you met Devon.
Mm-hmm.
And so meeting him as a hunter, what was your first impression of him?
My first impression was, yeah, not the best. My first impression, he came there direct from the slaughterhouse, just full of blood all over. So it was like, what's up, guy? I don't want to come close to you.
And then how did you start becoming interested in him? What kind of did he do to change your mind a little bit?
Well, his character was quite interesting for me. He was a sympathetic guy, so we went for some drinks talking. And the first talk was actually about elephant hunting. Showed me pictures and videos, and first I was like, no, serious. But his passion, that was the thing. He was like, it was not just talking about it. I could feel that his passion, his whole heart is with it. And the way he talked about nature, everything, it was interesting, because it was like this contrast. I couldn't understand it, actually. So it was kind of interesting.
So what changed your mind being a vegan hunting? What was that changed your mind and your views on hunting?
Well, it was, he invited me to come with him. And it was actually the experience. I would never change my mind just of reading something, or, I mean, you can get some documentaries about hunting, but that was, I came with him and I experienced it. And it was to see how much hard work it is. And you see, my mind always, I'm like, I'm part of the circle if I eat that meat. I'm not better as the one killing it, because I'm the reason why it got killed. So I was like, okay, I'm eating it now, I have to check out. So, and he was really that awesome guy telling me, yeah, the truth about hunting and this experiencing this hard work, and actually how many ethical questions are involved in that. It is not just you going out shooting something, it's so much hard work, and you must know nature, you must know the wildlife. And that was so amazing for me.
So what positive effects have you seen from hunting?
Positive effects, definitely. Here in Africa, in Namibia, the community profits so much of it. We live with nature, that's so different. We live with and from nature, from the wildlife and with wildlife. We are the ones giving them food if there's dry season, and we check if everything is in order, if the balance is right. And if you see how it looks like if the balance is not in order, it's a mess up. And as I experienced that, it's so different. And the community is living from that. If you see that people happy, if you bring them meat, if you see them, they their whole life is about keeping that everything in balance, because they live from that. It's not going just to a slaughterhouse, getting the meat from. We have to check everything is in order. And if you see that, how happy it makes people, and if you see wildlife like this, it's just amazing.
What advice would you give a non-hunter to better understand hunting?
Get the experience. Come here and go with and see what's happening, what's really happening, and get your own thought about it. It's not helping to just read things or to just watch TV. It's get your own thought about it, get your own experience. Go with hunters and check it out. That's actually the best. And then you can talk about it and you can think about what's really going on.
Julia, it's been really a pleasure to get to know you and to see your views on hunting and to learn how you viewed hunting and how you view it now. So thank you for that.
Thank you too.
Nawa, Nawa. Yeah, Nawa.
At the end of our safari, we got to do something absolutely incredible. We got to load the animals up, drive them into town, and give them to some kids at the Ben Hur school. Now, some of these kids actually live here year-round. Their families just don't have the money for them, and so they stay here. This is actually their family, and they live off maize or cornmeal. So to get these animals, they were very, very appreciative to have this protein. They came out of the classrooms, they welcomed us with open arms, and for their appreciation, they sang and danced for us all day long. It was definitely the highlight of the trip.